I think on the physician side, the misconception is that cat scratch is the only Bartonella disease. I think the reason this is somewhat prevalent is that cat scratch has been, quote, the term for Bartonellosis over the years, 50 years ago, at least when it was termed. And now we know much more about Bartonella and have much better diagnostic.
So this is actually where we stand today. If you're not completely up to date, there are 25 species and 3 subspecies that are officially recognized. And if any of you are responsible for these guys, if you could get them officially recognized, that would be really super.
I'm not going to spend any time today on the fact that a lot of diseases, particularly in veterinary medicine, where these vector-borne organisms persist for years, result as a consequence of co-infections or as a result of an immunologic imbalance that ultimately the immune system starts destroying erythrocytes, platelets, or other cells in the body. But I think these are all important concepts that as we consider the overall diagnosis, we have to keep in mind.
So when you look at the clinical manifestations in humans, cats, and dogs, of Behenseli and also B. vinsoni Burkhoffii in dogs, I think you can see that there's some common themes. Lymphadenitis, basilar angiomatosis in humans and a couple cases in dogs, uveitis and ocular lesions, very common in humans with cat scratch disease, seen occasionally in cats and dogs, and chronic bacteremia. It doesn't occur too much in humans, but cats, of course, can be infected for life. In terms of endocarditis, myocarditis, there is a predilection for Bartonella species for cardiac tissue, and that's been well described in humans, especially for Quintana. Seen relatively less in cats, but seen in dogs. Prolonged fever, certainly in humans. And this occurs most frequently when humans are immunocompromised and infected with a heterologous strain, not a human tropic strain. Lethargy, weight loss, anorexia, neurologic symptoms, very common in people with cat scratch disease. Encephalitis is less common, but often seen. Arthritis and joint pain, glomerulonephritis, and reproductive disorders have been demonstrated by Bruno Chamel in cats.
So my last slide, I just would like to conclude by saying that I consider Bartonella the most important infectious disease problem for veterinary medicine. And I believe that because of the large number of vectors, large number of reservoir hosts that are vector competent, and because this is a stealth pathogen that is extremely difficult to detect in both animals and people. And again, many, many veterinarians sitting in this audience are very concerned about the overall impact of this information on the animals that we take care of and our profession.
Why is Bartonella such a problem? It's such a problem because it's so hard to diagnose, and it looks like a lot of other diseases.
Very short background. I don't need probably convince you to accept that probably Bartonella enterocarditis is probably the most severe form of Bartonella infections among immunocompetent patients. Dr. Branchford tried to protect Bartonella, saying that they're not so bad guys, they don't kill usually people, but Bartonella enterocarditis does kill people, and even among this small group of limited group of patients, it's still we have some fatal cases.
And so I think it's sort of important to comment on the utility of case series on culture negative endocarditis. So from Dr. Fournier, Dr. Raoul from Marseille, where because of reports of this, it makes the average practicing cardiologist and infectious disease physician consider Hugh fever, Bartonella, and culture negative endocarditis. And we will always now, for the question of culture negative endocarditis, we're going to check Bartonella and Hugh fever serologies in addition to other things.
In the context of Bartonella in this slide, I think there's two things that are important diagnostically. One, if theoretically a patient sample that we process today had just one Bartonella in it, tomorrow it'll have two, the next day it'll have four, and obviously most samples are not going to start out with one organism, but what has made this genus so difficult is this long dividing time. So, fortunately, I think, not being trained as a microbiologist, in conjunction with a postdoc scientist, Dr. Sushama Santaki, we asked the question, if all of the good Bartonella researchers were finding that sheep kids, deer kids, sand flies, fleas, lice, and ultimately, most recently, ticks might be vector competent for transmitting these organisms, would they be happier and would they grow better in an insect biochemical composition as compared to a mammalian growth media? And I think fortunately the answer to that question was yes. So if we back up just a bit, I think it's important to acknowledge, regardless of the targeted organism, all infectious disease diagnostic tests have limitations. And it's clearly important for the clinician and the diagnostician to understand these limitations. So some of the limitations in general, whenever we're approaching, and I in particular, as Jane showed yesterday, if you have an immunocompromised patient, most of the Bartonellas are extracellular. I think in an immunocompetent patient, we really don't know whether these bacteria are intracellular, extracellular, or both at this point in time. Serology certainly should be done, in my opinion, in all patients in which we're contemplating a diagnosis, but as we all know, it doesn't confirm active infection. We'll talk about the fact that both in dogs and in people, we are amazed at the number of infected individuals that are seronegative, and whether this is a manifestation of using the wrong antigens or a manifestation that some individuals are actually anergic and do not produce antibodies is yet to be determined. I don't think we're ever going to have an antigen test for Bartonella because I don't think it's ever going to be sensitive enough. And obviously PCR demonstrates active infection, but what we found is in and of itself, it is not always sensitive enough to detect in patient samples. So from that, once we figured out that this insect media might grow Bartonella better and enhance our ability to find it in patient samples, Ashley Duncan, a PhD student in the lab working with Ricardo Maggi, described what we called the BACGM platform. Yeah, I would guess that this may be as complicated a diagnostic platform to confirm infection with an infectious agent that now exists, because from every sample we extract DNA, and for all human samples, as Dr. Moziani showed you yesterday, that includes independent PCRs from both blood and serum. Blood and serum are both incubated into BACGM enrichment culture, and at 7 days and 14 days, DNA is extracted and a PCR is done. And at 7 and 14 days, we subculture on an auger plate, and at that point, if something actually grows, a Bartonella-specific PCR is done.
So with regard to antibiotic choices, most of you know this, our intracellular antibiotics are not silent. Gentamicin is silent, but it's IV, it has ototoxicity and nephrotoxicity, and we can't use it long term. So, you know, I believe personally in my patients there's been no role for IV antibiotic therapy, and I don't even think it's is necessarily going to be helpful, because there's even theoretical consideration that we're not treating gut tissue as well as if we use oral products. Azithromycin is a concern. We know in animals that resistance develops very rapidly. I've been using pyrethromycin. I started using azithromycin lately, pyrethromycin and/or mycobutin. And the antibiotic, the probiotic use is an absolute must to manage these patients correctly and safely. Coagulopathy, just like there are immunogenetic predispositions, there are coagulation genetic predispositions. And it's important to evaluate and manage these. We use some enzymes, low-dose aspirin. If they have CNS symptoms, I use Plavix. We discuss the cytokine inhibition issues. So far, and I think there'll be more, but we have four well-documented cases of persistence after more than 6 months of double antibiotic therapy. A lot of these patients are feeling fine, so it takes a little work, but I convinced them that having Bartonella and feeling well is an acceptable situation, and we don't have to be so obsessive that we get them into trouble with ongoing antibiotic therapy. So there is a healthy carrier state, but what we don't know is what the long-term implications are of allowing someone to be a Bartonella carrier. If the treatment were easier, faster, simpler, safer, we could just treat these folks, but given how long and complicated the course of treatment are today, I think it doesn't make sense if someone's healthy and bacteremic to engage them in treatment other than maybe some natural conservative approaches.